My paper's entitled Compulsory Voting, Benefits and Hazards, Lessons from Australia and Elsewhere. I'm not going to be spending very long on the benefits of compulsory voting because I really want to focus on the kind of practical obstacles that might confront electoral administrators in the UK if they were to introduce compulsory voting for first-time voters. So I've written this directly as a kind of companion paper to Sarah's paper. But I should say before I start that I think CV for first-time voters is a great idea. I think it could really reinvigorate British democracy, and I think it's in dire need of invigoration because it's turnout decline and turnout inequality in that decline, and it's getting quite bad. Now, just briefly, I'll talk about the benefits of compulsory voting, just to put you in the mood and to prime you for all the other stuff I'm going to say, to make you love it a bit more, and hopefully as much as Sarah and I do. I should say before going that Sarah and I, the kind of work we do, Sarah's more of an empirical person, I'm more of a normative person, so our work complements each other's very well, and we sort of rely on each other's work in a lot of ways to, you know, I always need the empirical, I like to do empirically informed normative work, and she always has a normative aspect to the empirical work, so we actually just work together very well on that from a distance. So my paper is basically normative, but I have a lot of practical tips about what could be done, building on experience from Australia, which I believe has been a very successful compulsory voting regime. Now, the first and most obvious benefit of compulsory voting is its capacity to raise turnout very dramatically. We know that turnout decline is a near universal phenomenon in voluntary voting industrial democracies worldwide. People have been trying every kind of remedy that's available, neglecting the compulsory voting, but all the remedies that they apply simply aren't doing the job. And there's only one, you know, they might improve it by a few percentage points, but not in the dramatic way it needs to be improved. But there's one method with proven efficacy, and that is compulsory voting. When it's administered properly, it's the most efficient and effective means for raising and maintaining high and socially even turnout. And that's really the important thing, that the turnout is socially even. What universally happens in voluntary voting system is that turnout is concentrated, as Sarah's already alluded to, among the well-off. So compulsory voting is the only institutional mechanism that can actually achieve turnout in the 90% range on its own. And its effect on turnout is immediate, and it's also enduring. It happens straight away, and you'll get up to 30-plus percentage points rise in turnout, which is very dramatic, and then that will endure. It won't just last for that election. It'll keep going. People always trot out evidence from settings like New Zealand and Malta and say, well, look, you can get high turnout in these other voluntary voting systems, so it's just as high as we have in the Australian system. In all the settings that people cite that have high turnout, they have an unusually large coincidence of variables and factors likely to stimulate turnout. It would be very hard, if you don't already have those naturally occurring in some cases, it's going to be very hard to stimulate them. And if they're not naturally occurring, it's going to be very hard to introduce them. That kind of argument doesn't really wash. In general, compulsory voting is the only mechanism that's going to give you a high turnout in a very decisive way. So some people who criticise compulsory voting advocates say, well, what's the point? It's just going through the motions. It's just raising turnout. What do you actually get for your money? Does it make things any better? Well, it does make things better. From a normative point of view, it makes governments more legitimate. It makes democracy more governed by the people, of the people, for the people, and all those sort of desiderata that we like. But also, what do you get in your hand when you actually have high turnout? Well, you do get some very good things in your hand if you have high turnout. You get better government. And by that I mean more representative government, and by that I mean more democratic government. It produces governments that are better able to act for the people, and it correlates with government that is more responsive to the needs and priorities of the entire electorate, not just with the well-off. And it's also correlated with lower levels of corruption and higher levels of citizen satisfaction and trust. And Sarah has tracked all those effects empirically. High and socially even turnout is better from a representative point of view because governments are more attentive to the demands of habitual voting groups. Currently in voluntary voting system, voting is just helping those who are already better off. The old adage, if you don't vote, you don't count, is very true. as Marty Wattenberg, who's a famous American psephologist, once said to me, politicians are not idiots, they know who their customers are. And they certainly do. If you're not one of their customers, they're not going to look after you. And there are a gazillion studies that have detected a strong relationship between electoral participation rate and the implementation of public policies that affect spending in important areas like health services, education and public amenities. And this relationship is particularly true of redistribution that occurs at the lower income spectrum. So people can actually map. They'll go to an area where there are a lot of African-American people, and when they become enfranchised into the system, suddenly they've got garbage collection and suddenly they've got street lighting. It's very easy to track. And Sarah has done a lot of that tracking as well. So not surprisingly, here is the third benefit. Settings with compulsory voting have less income equality than voluntary systems. See Sarah Birch, 2009. Four, in general, compulsory voting has been shown to lower levels of political corruption. And five, this is compulsory voting regimes are correlated with high levels of satisfaction with democracy. So there are lower levels of perceived corruption, which contributes to the satisfaction, and lower levels of actual corruption. And people are happier with their democracy. They perceive it as better functioning than people in voluntary systems. And we see that in the Australian case. Australians grumble all the time, but actually they are very satisfied with their system. Over 90% believe it matters who you vote for, and they think it makes a big difference who you vote for. And a very high percentage, over 85%, think the democracy is working very well. Now I'm going to move on to the hazards of introducing a compulsory voting regime, and I wouldn't want to discourage anyone from doing it. I think it's a very good idea. But there are things that you need to watch out for to make sure that the system is going to work. Your number one problem is going to be public resistance. We don't want the public resisting it, because if the public don't like something, they will subvert it and it won't work. You have to make the public like compulsory voting. But to do that, it's not enough to just try and trick them into it with a bunch of false advertising. The system actually has to be good. The public aren't idiots. If the system's no good, they won't like it. So you have to actually make the system good. And so we know Britain is the most promising case for an introduction of compulsory voting first time, or for anyone, because it's probably the country with the most promising outlook on compulsory voting, the most likely acceptance of it. Of any of the major industrialised democracies. They're the most open to the idea. So we're already on a winner there, I think. But what can Britons do to make sure, if this reform were ever to occur, to make sure that it was accepted by the public? Because if it's not accepted by the public, it will not be effective. You won't have compliance, and you want compliance. And you won't have approval, and you need approval. Again, the Australian system is very useful here. Before going on to how Australia helps us here, I want to briefly make a point that I'm pretty sure you would subscribe to, that I would not defend, we talked about this last night, so I think you would not defend all types of compulsory regimes, and it's not appropriate for every setting. So people say when you advocate compulsory voting, you think that everyone should run out and get it. I actually got an email yesterday from a prospective PhD student from Kenya saying, I'd like to come and work with you so I can work out how to have better elections in Kenya, because everyone's shooting each other every time we have an election here. And I just felt sad. I was thinking, introducing compulsory voting is not going to help you there, because just more shooting. You need so much to get that system off the ground. You need so much infrastructure and so much development and so much support for compulsory voting to work well. So compulsory voting only works well in settings that meet quite high standards, and where compulsory voting is or has a good chance of being administered properly, which it does in the UK. So for a compulsory voting regime to be effective in terms of assuring high turnout and enjoying high levels of public acceptance, and appropriate insofar as it's not being used as a mechanism to forge consent. So, that was a Freudian slip, but it will forge contempt. But some places have used it as a mechanism to forge consent. You don't want that.